functioning landing gear was saved from disaster by a pickup truck.
I mean, I was right out here. I was afraid for the people on the plane.
Like the front wheels weren't coming down, and so it needed help landing.
Inside the terminal, passengers awaiting their flights watched it all unfold.
And you heard this like huge commotion, and everyone rushed toward the window.
Yeah.
We see an airplane coming in, and it's gonna crash, or so I think.
This truck just comes out of nowhere, and it just like came right under it, and the plane just landed right on top of the truck.
Meanwhile, inside the aircraft, passengers had been expecting the worst. The truck, a Nissan Frontier, was driven by an airport mechanic. He says he doesn't consider himself a hero.
I heard it coming over the radio. The plane was coming in, so I just had to gas it, get it up to full speed. The Pro 4X off-roading package, this thing can handle some pretty rugged stuff.
More, including reaction from pilots and air traffic control. It's coming up tonight at 11.
So how did you like this video?
A lot.
Very good. Very good. See how many people that truck driver saved?
Must be about
300. Yes?
300.
400.
300, no? Yeah. And do you think this could really happen or is it just a video?
It can really happen.
Okay. Those of you who feel this really happened, just raise your hands. Okay. And those who feel that this is just a video, please raise your hands. Okay. So minority is right.
Yeah.
Okay. This aeroplane is too heavy for its landing gear to be taken in a pickup truck.
No.
But this is a video for Nissan Frontier. That's the name of the truck they were promoting. This is Manish's idea to introduce the talk, so I think it's a very wonderful idea. So we move forward. Before we tell you, how do aeroplanes fly, we thought we'll just introduce you to our atmosphere. Children, do you know what is the atmosphere?
Yeah.
Okay, what is the atmosphere?
It's
the
layer.
It is the
layer.
The layer that surrounds the
Earth. That's right. So this is the Earth, and these are the layers. Okay, there's not just one layer; there are many layers, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody knows all the layers? Okay, tell me.
Troposphere, stratosphere, mesosphere,
troposphere,
and
exosphere. Wow, that's very nice. So, see, he knew it. No? So starting from troposphere right up to exosphere, so there are various layers of atmosphere. So this is where all our flying takes place, okay, closer to the Earth than to exosphere. So this is a graph which shows the temperature as we go up. On the right hand side, you see on the x-axis, temperature is marked. So in troposphere, the temperature reduces as we go up, and in stratosphere, it remains steady for some time, and after that it increases in stratosphere, in mesosphere comes down again, in thermosphere goes up again. So it just keeps going up and down, doesn't know what to do, no? and on the left hand side, if you see, we see what happens in what layer. So most of the flying takes place in troposphere or stratosphere. You see meteorites at about 50 kilometers. You see aurora lights above 80 kilometers, and space shuttle, they have to go out in the space. So they are in exosphere and outside. Okay, this is another picture of layers of atmosphere. On the right bottom you see, there's Mount Everest at about 11 kilometers. Cloud tops are higher than that, and our aircraft fly is still higher than that. Radio sounded balloons, sorry. Okay, you see these balloons? Okay, these are the balloons which are released by met stations. They go up, and while they are going up, they transmit information about temperature, humidity, etc. Okay, so they go to about 30 to 40 kilometers. Then you see again meteors, you see the space shuttle, aurora lights, and satellites. So satellites are very, very far out in the space. This is the composition of the air. Okay? So, you all know what all gas is? Yeah. Anybody who doesn't understand? So, the oxygen which we breathe comes from the atmosphere, and we have nitrogen, argon, carbon dioxide, neon, and the proportion of other gases is very, very small. Most of it is nitrogen and oxygen. No, rest is all very, very small. So this is what air is made of. Okay, so air is a combination of gases, and we are these gases. Okay, we know the layers of the atmosphere, and we know that air is made of various gases, but how does an aeroplane fly? That is why we are here, right? So to show that, I'll show you a few things which will be of very good, great interest to children. So I'll say what happens when we blow over a strip of paper. I'll just show you. I would actually like this tall boy to come and just help me. Yeah.
What's your
name?
Siddharth.
Yes. Okay, Siddharth, you just do something. We are going to hold this strip of paper and we are going to blow over it, not under it, over it, and see what happens.
So that you just hold this. Just do that. Can you all see? Blow over it, yeah. Long breath and blow over it. Yes, one much more. Yeah. So if you see when you blow over it, the paper tends to rise. Is there any reason for it to rise?
But now it's
air pressure.
Okay, the glory is so bright. I would have to please my. Okay. What happens when you blow air between two strips of paper? I think this is all toilet paper, huh?
Let's clarify unused.
I don't know, somebody brought it down. Okay, a little bit of draft from this AC. I'll just try to keep it apart and I'll blow through it. Sorry, I can't really show this very well because. So when I'm blowing through these two strips of paper, they don't move apart. They tend to come closer. You know, that's what should happen, but because the drafts are not very clear.
Yes,
sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
they're sticking here.
There is one more. I have a triangle of, I'll just make a cone of this paper and I'll blow over this. Let's see if I can show it. Okay, I'm not able to show it because the surface is not level, but instead of expanding, these two sheets, these two edges will come closer. And somebody's already answered as to why does this happen. Why does this happen?
Air pressure.
Air pressure. What happens to air pressure? Sorry?
The paper moving lower.
Goes up. Yeah. What happens to air pressure?
Increases.
Increases inside or decreases inside?
Increases inside.
No.
Decreases.
So pressure increases, volume increases.
Yes. So I'll just show you one more. Do you see this? Can everybody see this? Why is the ball not falling?
Air
pressure from below. Okay, but then why is it not falling now?
Bring a pole. You can have to keep going
down. You have to pull it down. You have to keep pulling it down.
The poles are equal.
Okay.
They cancel each other.
So there is a lower pressure all around it.
Yes.
Pulls it in all direction and
okay. This is the right explanation. Now,
when I blow air, whether it is over a strip of paper or between the two strips of paper or between the cone which I made, why the papers tend to come closer or why a single paper tends to fly is because there is low pressure created when I blow over it. Okay. Similarly, when I used the hair dryer and I popped a ball over it, it remains in the air and does not fall even if, when I tilt it. So it's not the pressure of the air which is keeping it up, it is a low pressure of air which has been accelerated by the blow dryer. Okay. So it's the acceleration of the air which is keeping it up, not the pressure from below. That's why even when I tilted it, it didn't fall, because the stream of low air pressure is surrounding the ball. Okay. Because surrounded by low pressure, on its periphery is high pressure, so ball is not falling. Right? So it is all a matter of pressure. So this is Daniel Bernoulli. What we showed in our experiments was defined in mathematical terms by this scientist called Daniel Bernoulli. Okay. What does Daniel Bernoulli say? This was called Bernoulli's theorem, Bernoulli's principle. It says that an increase in the speed of moving air or a flowing fluid is accompanied by a decrease in the air or fluid's pressure or some of the kinetic pressure and potential energy of the fluid at any point remains constant, provided that the flow is steady, irrotational, that means not rotating, and frictionless, and the fluid is incompressible. Now, these are conditions apply. So just disregard it. Basically, what it means is that when you accelerate the air, now it causes decrease of pressure. Do you understand this now? Any child who is not interested in this part, this is an important part, rest of all stories. You understood this? Okay. We'll continue with the Bernoulli's theorem. In a steady flow of a fluid, the pressure of the fluid decreases when the velocity of the fluid increases. Okay, so this is a tube called a Venturi tube. No? You have the tube which has got air coming from left to right, and area here, this is area A1, this is A2, and this is A1. Now A stands for area, okay? And here is P1 and P2. See, on the left, on the right, you see A2 is less than A1, this is A2, okay? What happens there? V2 is more than V1. Because the sum of pressure energy, kinetic energy, and potential energy has to remain same as per Bernoulli's theorem or Bernoulli's principle. So when the air moves through this constriction, area being less, the airflow accelerates. Okay, the sum of total energy remaining same. Now, okay, there's a volume of air which is entering this point. It has to exit this point because of the direction of airflow. Okay. Here the area through which it has to pass is small. For the total energy, for the sum total of energy to remain same, more air has to go. So that means more particles of air, so they have to accelerate to maintain the total energy constant. Okay, so this is that area. So if the constriction is there, the airflow will accelerate. Everybody has understood? Okay. What I've done is I just drawn these two curves to indicate the Venturi. Okay. So here we have the air coming from the left to the right, and these are two constrictions, constriction made by two curves, and reduced pressure takes place here because the airflow is accelerating at this point and going out here. Even if I remove this top portion and have only the lower portion, because over some distance it is undisturbed air. The air is disturbed only, accelerated only from here to here. Rest is all undisturbed. So even if I have only one part of the curve of Venturi, even then reduced pressure will take place. Has everybody understood this? Okay. So this, yes sir?
But that reduction in pressure would be substantially less or somewhat less?
It would be less. It would be less, but design takes care of that. Design of the wing will take care of that. So this is how wings are made. Okay, airflow comes from left to right again. It is going over the wing. and wing is shaped in that curve. Notice the curve here? Okay. So while the air is going over the wing, it accelerates. When it accelerates, the lower pressure is produced over the top surface of the wing, and high pressure over the lower surface of the wing, and that is what gives lift. Understood? You want me to repeat this?
Yes.
Okay. So, Bernoulli's theorem says that sum total of energy has to remain constant. No? So when you pass air through a constriction or what you call a venturi tube or venturi, the air will accelerate so that the total potential energy can be constant. Here area is more, area is less here, area is more here. So at any point P1, P2 and if there is a P3 here, everywhere the total potential energy has to remain the same. Sum total of all the energy has to remain the same. So here, while the area has come down, the velocity has to increase to keep the total energy constant. Is this reasoning understood? So this is what happens. This is how the wings are shaped here. Sorry.
So according to what you said, it's basically that there is inversely proportional as the area.
Absolutely right. If area decreases, velocity. Absolutely right. You are right. It is right. So this is the shape of the wing. I've first shown as a part of a venturi, and then I removed the top curve and have only the bottom curve. The airflow will still accelerate over the top surface because from the undisturbed air to this portion of the wing, which is being put in the airflow, there will be some reduction in pressure. And this is how a wing is designed. A wing is designed in a curved fashion, so the top surface is more curved than the bottom. Okay, here is a picture of an aeroplane that lands on water. These aeroplanes really have to come down to very slow speeds. So here, if you see the curvature on top, and not so much of curvature, or the inverse curvature here, and this top surface is what gives the lift. Everybody is okay with this?
Can I just?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Clarification.
Yes, sir.
When the plane takes off,
yes, sir.
What sort of pressure differences we are talking about? Assuming atmosphere below.
Yes.
Above the wing, how much pressure will be for vacuum?
It will be equal to the weight. The pressure, the lift force which will take place on top of the wing surface would have to equal the weight for the aircraft to get airborne. As long as the lifting pressure is, or lifting force is less, the aircraft will be on ground. So when it is lifting out, that means the lift has to be so much, that means the airflow has to be so much and acceleration has to be so much that so much of low pressure is created on top of the wing which makes the aircraft go up. Yes, sir.
So, if I'm asking prematurely, let me know. I can definitely see. So, this is what I've read in the books, but I've also thought if this is the plane, just Bernoulli's would not be able to lift the entire plane. And maybe, just as you shape it upwards, and the jet forces are pushing it in at a theta angle, and the wind resistance, as the wind hits the body, it gives an upward force, which is, like a little. Is that a factor or is that not even a factor?
Okay, yeah, it's a question. What you're saying is right. A little premature. I would be, we have a slide to show that. Not exactly that, but we'll come to that slide. So the question which he's asking is whether it's just the Bernoulli's theorem or just the lower pressure on the wing or are the engines also helping in the lift? Okay. So what we are assuming is that there is enough thrust for it to go up, more like a rocket, which is not the case. Okay, this is again the top surface of a very slow moving aircraft. You see what a big curve it is. So when the air goes over it, it causes low pressure on top, high pressure at the bottom, and causes lift. I would be very happy to explain if there is any question. Yeah, okay. Okay, here is a diagrammatical representation of a cross-section of a wing. So this is the cross-section of a wing. This is what, and we call it aerofoil. Sorry, I should have mentioned that earlier. Cross-section of a wing is what we call an aerofoil. This aerofoil, more or less, if you see, is symmetrical in the sense the curvature on top is almost same as curvature at the bottom. but the angle at which it is meeting the airflow is positive. It is a little nose up. So acceleration takes place because of that angle. And acceleration takes place on top. And causing low pressure on top. Here is the representation of air particles moving over the surface. If you see these two dots, this dot is moving much faster than the dots, though they came together to the beginning of the leading edge. This is the leading edge of the wing. See, this one is accelerating and this one is coming slow. So this acceleration on top surface of the wing is what is causing lower pressure, which results in lift.
And this air is basically because of the speed of the aircraft.
Absolutely. So you need the engines to push the aircraft forward so that the air can flow over the wings. Absolutely right, sir.
But the reason that the upper molecules and the lower molecules are not moving and meeting back at the same time is that just the extra distance of the curve?
It is Bernoulli's theorem, the curvature on top. It is the curvature on top. So giving it more distance and also the curvature on top. In the sense, it is narrowing. See, this portion is free stream airflow. Okay? So this is undisturbed airflow. This portion is disturbed because of the aerofoil being in the airflow. So it is only this portion which is getting accelerated.
And if I have to increase, you know, let's say keeping everything else the same, increasing the smoothness of the upper surface and increasing roughness would be a factor?
Yes.
And increasing the curvature distance so that
yes. Yeah. So that is if I have to explain to you various types of aerofoil and in various roles. In a fighter aircraft, an aerofoil is very sharp, and this is a thick for a fighter aircraft, but quite good for a transport aeroplane. Okay, for a low speed aeroplane, this portion will be even thicker. I'll just go back. Just see how thick it is. No, this is like a glider's wing. No? This is a very slow moving aircraft. I don't have a picture for a fast moving aircraft, but I could show it right here. So this is a sharper or a more streamlined aerofoil, and this is quite streamlined. Okay, this is showing an aerofoil. Line joining the leading edge and trailing edge is called the chord, and this is the wind, how it meets the aerofoil, and the angle between the chord and the relative wing is called angle of attack. Angle of attack decides the lift that is created. So that answers your question to some extent. No, the angle will make a difference. So what a pilot does is, when he is accelerating, once adequate amount of speed is achieved on the runway, he changes the angle of attack. He does something which brings the nose up. After that, the aircraft goes up. So that means the lift is also increasing, and the angle of attack increases, causing increase in lift, and that's how they go up. So it is not the thrust of the engine. No, it is not a rocket. That would be a rocket, right? Answering your question. Okay, this a little more explanation of the aerofoil. It's the aerofoil shape of the wing that generates lift. Air splits at the front, air pressure reduces on top, increases at the bottom, and accelerates down. So even this downwards force of the air also gives it a reciprocal force to go up. No, this is reaction is to lift it up. Captain Gundeep told me to introduce the formula here. You know? Because if things get too interesting, then we must introduce formula. So here I am. No, I'm not going to derive it because I forgot it. I can't derive it now. But this is the formula for lift. Okay, lift is half d. It's also called rho. No, v square s cl. Cl is the measure of the angle of attack. Various things. The shape of the wing. The angle of attack and various other things, even the surface. Now, you talk about the rough surface and the fine surface. So that also decides on what is the CL. So CL is a multiple as which decides how much lift is created vis-a-vis the velocity. Okay. So the formula is lift is equal to half d v square s CL. S is the surface of the wing, v is the velocity, d is the density of air, and this is the formula. So lift will depend on is equal to half rho v square s or half dv square SCL. Lift which must equal the airplane's weight in pounds. D is density of the air. This will change due to altitude. These values can be found in an ICAO standard atmosphere. V is velocity of an aircraft expressed in feet per second. S is the wing area. Square feet and CL is coefficient of lift, which is determined by the type of aerofoil and angle of attack. Okay, so this is the formula for lift. Mathematical explanation of how lift is produced and what is lift equal to. All okay, shall we move forward? Okay, now guess how much lift is required for this? How many tons? Come, kiddos, tell me, how many tons?
Thousands of.
Thousands of.
10,000 kg.
Oh, that is. 10,000 kg is one truck outside. 10 tons is chicken feet, yeah.
600 tons.
That is a very accurate figure, okay? Very accurate figure. It started with about 550 pounds and at 550 tons, they have moved it to about past 600 tons now, okay? So an Airbus 380 is more than 600 tons. So that's the kind of lift we need to get this body going up. Okay, helicopters have a similar shape. Only thing is helicopter aerofoil is curved equally from both top and bottom. So we call it symmetrical aerofoil. Okay, so here we have a helicopter. Everybody can see this helicopter? Okay, so wings of a fixed wing aircraft are fixed to the helicopter, fixed to the aeroplane. In helicopter, the wings move, but they are wings anyway. Okay. So this is aerofoil of a helicopter rotor. We call it rotor blade. We don't call it wings. And this is how same formula applies to helicopters. Same application of the same formula. Here the thing to see is that V here in a fixed wing, the V is the forward velocity of the aeroplane, which is generated by those jet engines or whatever engine that we use. Engines will be covered extensively by Captain Namdeo. In helicopters, it is the rotation of the blade. So rotational velocity is the V here, right? So more or less, helicopters work on the same principles as aeroplanes. Not much difference. In a helicopter, the side of the blade which is going forward, it is not only moving forward in circles, but it's also meeting the air which is coming from ahead. So V here is far more than the V here. Causes some amount of imbalance. Okay. We'll not cover that. You're already bored, so move forward. Okay, this is an aerofoil. Again, just showing the aerofoil. In the beginning, the flow is quite laminar, and then it becomes disturbed.
In
yes,
the
sorry.
Previous diagram.
Yeah.
How does the mu variable cause forward flight?
How does the
mu variable? It says mu is equal to 0.3. How does it cause forward flight?
Okay.
How's
the? No, Don't worry about it. I'll not be able to explain because I don't know the formula. But basically, you have velocity is the velocity of the rotation plus the velocity which is with which the aircraft is moving forward. This portion of the blade is getting more velocity and this portion is getting less velocity.
Captain Joshi.
Yes, sir.
One question. You said that the helicopter symmetrical aerofoil.
Yes, sir.
So the upper surface is similar shape as the lower surface.
Yes, sir.
How does the Bernoulli principle work then? Because you know you said that because of Bernoulli principle, on the upper half the air has to travel a longer distance.
Yes, sir. So what we do is we change the CL. No? We change the coefficient of lift by changing the angle of attack. Okay. When the aircraft is resting on ground, we don't want to unnecessarily get airborne. So we have to have zero lift at some point. So when the aircraft is started up, the engine is started up. We change the angle of attack together of all the blades, so that generates lift upwards.
Recently, I saw that the new aircrafts. I've seen that the end they have put a curvature like this.
Yes, sir. Those are called winglets
canard wings.
Here we have.
Yeah, at the end.
Yeah.
Yes.
This is advanced design, and now it is being adopted by all the new aeroplanes. There's something called wingtip vortices. The lower pressure on top and higher pressure at the bottom. At the end of the wing, it tends to rotate. Okay, and that causes some loss of lift. So to prevent that loss of lift, these winglets are made. So earlier, only Boeing had adopted. If you notice, Boeing always had those winglets. Now even Boeing, only Airbus had it, now even Boeing's have it. Most of all fast moving aeroplanes now have these design features.
They for fuel reduction mainly.
Sorry?
They for fuel reduction mainly.
Yeah, because losses are taking place, so it'll save fuel. No, because the lift is now saved, the lift which was going waste, okay, and because of rotation. So,
sir, two questions.
Yes, sir.
Let's say in a Dreamliner, it's a composite wing, there is a lot of deformation of the shape when the plane is flying. Other reason for deformation is icing, because of which planes have gone down. So how does the aerofoil change because of wing deformation or icing?
Okay, I welcome this interruption because this is, explain to you the wing design, sorry. We'll go back to this. Okay, the blades are normally made of, earlier the blades were all made from metal. They had something called a spar in front on the leading edge, very strong member, and then skin on the shaped aerofoil shape. And when the lift takes place, it not only lifts the aeroplane, it also lifts the skin. And starting from here, when lift takes place, this portion of the wing, as compared to this lift, it'll come up, it moves up in feet. No, you can, if you're, sir?
In the flight itself, we can see.
You can see it. No, when the aircraft is on ground, you see the wing tip. If you're sitting on an emergency seat, where you have to pay 600 rupees extra. No? You can see the wingtip, it is quite low, but when you get airborne, the same thing, you can see it lifting up. Even for that, they charge. So, one is structure is made to take that bending load. And second thing is about icing. Icing distorts. In case there is moisture and supercooled water droplets condense on the wing surface, they distort the shape of the wing. So that leads to loss of lift. So what they have done is they have heating of the blades. Okay. So blades are heated, or they have other devices which make sure that the icing does not take place. In any case, the airliners, when they fly, they are flying much higher than the zone where icing takes place. Icing takes place up to about minus 7 degrees of temperature. These guys are flying at minus 30, minus 20. So no icing takes place there. So the low speed aircraft who fly at lower altitudes. So icing accidents would normally take place on commuter variety, on these turboprops, which are used for short haul flights. Buffalo, there was an accident, very bad accident. Okay. This is the angle shown, and the lift is on the left, and the angle, as the angle increases, the lift, beyond a point, the lift, aircraft not able to sustain the loss of lift, and the stall takes place. Stall will be covered later. Sir, if I have zero angle of attack, even then some lift will take place. Okay. So for me, if I want a zero lift at this point, then angle will have to be nose down. So as the angle increases, lift increases beyond a certain point, the lift is no more possible and stall takes place.
So we are saying that at 8 degree down, the Bernoulli force is being cancelled by the lift force.
CL is negative.
Coefficient.
Sir?
Coefficient of lift is
Coefficient of lift is less. You reduce the angle.
So at landing time it will be minus 8
hours. No, sir. At landing time it is highest. No, because the V has reduced. For you to land safely on a runway and stop within the length of the runway, you need high CL, high lift, but no velocity. So the aircraft is able to stop within that distance. So that's why it is not, the aircraft always comes nose up. No? You saw that video also, the aircraft always comes nose up.
You come in nose up, speed's gonna be higher,
and
landing is gonna be bumpy, and
so
on.
It is going to land on its nose. How bad is that? Okay, again, one more one more picture of lift CL here and aircraft going and here aircraft stalls. You see the angle 2, 11, 20 on angle of attack versus lift. Okay, these are the forces on the aeroplane. So far we were talking about wings. This is aeroplane. Okay, in the aeroplane you have lift on top, thrust which takes the aircraft forward, drag, and weight is what is has to be counted by lift. In a helicopter, similar stuff takes place. And this is how a helicopter flies. Lift, air comes from top to bottom, aircraft rotors are rotating, and adequate lift is produced for the aircraft to get airborne. When the helicopter has to move forward, this whole thing has to be tilted. So there's control in the aircraft, which tilts the entire rotor disc, we call it rotor disc, entire disc is tilted forward and the helicopter moves forward. Okay, here the helicopter, if you see the lift component vertical and this is moved forward, so this is the rotor disc which is moved forward, dotted one, and that is what is making this helicopter go forward. Same thing, lift, weight, drag, thrust. Thrust is given by tilting the lift component forward in helicopters. This is the representation of the resultant of lift and thrust moved forward. And the aircraft is moving forward. Okay, have you heard of these words roll, pitch, and yaw? Young kids, tell me what is a roll, what is yaw, what is pitch?
Roll. Roll.
From left to right.
Yeah.
So when the wing, one wing goes up, the other wing
goes down.
Yeah. Okay. So that is roll. So this will be roll here. Okay. This one wing goes up and. Okay, what is yaw? Have you heard of yaw? Yes.
It's where you don't actually turn it, but the you makes a maneuver where the aircraft basically changes direction.
Absolutely.
Without actually turning it.
Very good. A very bright child here. So
the not bright, the GDSI is.
Okay. Can't take a compliment. Okay, fine. Okay. So yeah, yaw is when the wings are not tilted. But the nose turns from left to right or right to left.
With the rudder, right?
With the rudder. With the rudder. Yeah, we'll come to the rudder also. So, and what is pitch?
Up, down.
Up, down. The nose going up or down. Okay, that is pitch, absolutely right.
Perfect.
So, this is a diagram which is showing roll, yaw, and pitch. Everybody can see this? You can see this? Okay. And these are the controls inside a cockpit. This is a base. Sorry, you had a question? No. This is a, inside of all cockpits, cockpit of a small aeroplane. So this is a trainer aircraft. So you have this like a steering wheel. So you push this left down and this comes up like a wheel and it aircraft banks or rolls. You pull this from inside out. Like you have a steering wheel which can come out. So you pull it. It causes pitch, and then you have rudder pedals here, which cause yaw. Okay.
So on a side note, I've been curious. Its steering operation is very similar to cars, but in cars we have a full wheel, and why don't we have the full wheel here?
No, I'll just explain to you. The car steering is actually geared. Okay, the rotation is not linear. No, you have a gear which moves the car. You can't go around. In a aeroplane, you can keep going around also. The aeroplanes will keep rolling, no? In the same direction. So it is just that the forces required to turn an aeroplane are much less. In the sense, the rotation of the wheel required is much less for it to achieve what it needs to, where it needs to go. You see the difference between auto rickshaws and car. Otherwise, the motorizers and there, you know, and whether you have to really rotate the wheel. So it is that proportion of the force required or where you want to go.
This is simple. What improves the speed of the aeroplane? The forward thrust.
What?
How do you get the speed in an aircraft?
Because of the engines. Thrust produced by the engine.
How? So you
blow
the air
yes, that will be covered in our next session. Capt R N Ashish Namdeo is covering that. Okay, this is just showing a few things. This is the what we call the horizontal stabilizer, and behind that is again wing surfaces which can be moved for an elevator. This is the vertical stabilizer. Somebody said rudders. These are the rudders, the yellow portion. And these are the devices on the wing which increase lift whenever required. Okay. Small aeroplane showing ailerons which are at the end of the two wings, which call the roll. And here is the rudder, this calls yaw. Okay. And these are the elevator which call the pitching. Okay, so roll yaw pitch, this is the control which you need. This is the vertical stabilizer and rudder shown in vertically, and these are the elevators behind the horizontal stabilizer at the end of an aeroplane.
So, in case of passenger plane also, does it have capability like the Air Force planes to run around actually if in case they want to? Or they don't have a capability at all?
They can maneuver quite well, but not as much as a military fighter aircraft. They can turn quite well.
He's asking whether they can flip it. They can flip
also. It's possible.
They're not designed to flip it. They're not designed for that. No, see the structural load required. You want the wing to go up. If you reverse it, you know, similar what the doctor said about the load. The wing bends upwards. Maybe designed for only upward bending, not downward bending. So that would be.
Some are designed so well actually to
for maneuvers like that.
Because
so
aircraft
are
more smaller and maneuverable,
yeah.
So
yes.
And the length of the passenger aircraft might cause difficulties in actually doing evasive maneuvers, right?
It is mainly the lift required, because even maneuvers are carried out by changing the lift angle. It is upward lift which goes to side, the aircraft rolls, or move forward when you raise the nose up, so the aircraft pitches up.
So it doesn't suggest so that it could actually flip, because the weight is such and the length is such that it's possible, but then it won't be safe for everything.
See, if it is carrying weight, then lift to weight ratio is fine. No, it is just that it is not designed for those maneuvers. No?
Yes.
At certain angles, the structural damage could take place. Okay, this is just showing flaps. There's something called flaps, which allow you to come down at a lower speed. Okay, one more diagram showing aileron up here and the wing coming down, aileron down here and wing going up. Okay. Ailerons are what gives us roll. Okay, see this. These are the ailerons functioning at the end of the at the end of the wings. Okay, so this is how rolling takes place. Same lift, you change the angle of the lift and you can turn. Okay, so it is upward, it is not yaw, we don't turn because of the yaw, we turn because of the roll. Okay, and this is how the rolling needs to change in direction. Okay, this is again showing controls. This is a control in the aircraft which causes roll, yaw, sorry, pitch, and now last yaw. These are the yaw pedals, you see rudder movement. Okay, everybody understand rolling, yawing, pitching, and how the controls are there. Okay.
I have a doubt in
here. Yeah.
Sorry, So the one which goes up, it turns in that direction, right? And
the one which goes up at the end,
which
when
moves,
goes up,
where the angle increases, it turns in that direction.
No, that actually goes down. The where the okay. Yeah. See. This is coming up now, going down, coming up. Okay, so reciprocal. Okay, this is a helicopter, yes.
I've seen that at the time of landing, ailerons are quite active. So does it help at the time of landing also?
Yes, I have a few pictures of that. Again, you have to pay 600 rupees to see all that. Okay, so this is a rotor. So rotor is also quite flexible. They are not rigidly, put along the shaft of the main shaft, they can go up, down, they can lead and lag, that means in the same plane of rotation, they can go forward, come back, and they can pitch up and pitch down, we call it flapping. Okay, and their angle can also increase or decrease. That's why we need the CN for the whole rotor to go up. Okay, so the angle of attack can also be changed. So these are the hinges, and these are the movement that take place. Flapping, lagging, feathering. Feathering is basically change of angle, CL. This is a picture of a rotor. This is quite a complicated affair at the main rotor. There are various hinges which permit that dragging, flapping, and feathering. Okay, these are the controls of a helicopter. Helicopter controls, there is a stick, we just call it a stick or cyclic. These are collector controls. By raising this, they come up like a parking brake, they come up. Okay. So when you move these levers called collective levers, the lift changes collectively on all the bits. So aircraft lifts up because of this. And this is what changes the direction of the rotor disc, forward, left, right. So that's why being in one place, the aircraft can roll with go any direction, you know, forward, backwards, left or right. And these are the pedals, the green things. These are the pedals which make the tail rotor changes. Now that will be a separate topic, will be discussed separately. One more picture of a helicopter. Pedals required to turn and to counter torque and anti-torque. Now this torque and anti-torque, do you all understand? Okay. When there is torque, when torque is basically force in rotation, there is always an anti-torque reaction. And how that is countered in helicopters will be covered by Captain Namdeo. Okay, these are the devices we are talking about. No, these are things that you see when you are sitting on that emergency seat. Some more. This right in front is called slats. These are called flaps. Here, these are brakes. They can cause increase in drag and also give more lift. They change the CL. Okay, this is sorry.
When the flaps go down, what happens? When the flaps go up, what happens?
Okay, when the flaps go up, two things happen. Lift increases. There is an increase in CL, but there is also increase in drag. Okay?
Yeah.
So, you have a higher lift, which can be sustained at lower speed. But you also have drag, because the wing surface is increased and angle has come down, so more drag is being caused. This is what is required when you come in for landing. Okay, this is.
Does this also help in reducing the speed also?
Yes, of course. You can have higher thrust, it reduces. On approach, the pilot is continuously increasing the angle of the flap. No, initially, the less, then keeps increasing. So, as you come closer, the speed reduces and the lift increased. This is in front of the wing. They are called slats. They help in higher lift. At lower angles.
During takeoff, we have the slats deployed so that no.
Yes, at takeoff also, you are right. At takeoff, you have less angle, at landing, you have even a higher angle. Okay, one more picture of slats. And this aircraft is coming for landing, just see what all is deployed. You have the slats, you have the flaps, ailerons are level, aircraft is not turning, undercarriage is down. Just see the length of the slat which is open. And somebody talked about wingtip. This is to prevent wingtip vortices, so you have these winglets at the end of the.
So that would be a very complex machinery because it has to move, it has to take a lot of pressure because it.
Yes, it is. Yeah, it's very complicated. And if you notice, it takes place in stages. No? You see something moving, and you can. The noise can be heard in the in the passenger cabin. You can hear the whole thing going, the drama.
Yeah.
And when undercarriage comes down, there's a thud. No, undercarriage opens and locks. So all this is motorized. Everything is electric motors. So you need a lot of electric power to run these motors to operate these devices. Okay, this is the aircraft which has landed. You see, these are the airbags which are out.
Spoilers.
Yeah, and these are flaps which are down. All the flaps are down for higher drag, and airbags are out.
What's that black hole? Is that an accident or on the right side?
Sorry. Okay, this one?
No, right.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay. There's something called an APU, auxiliary power unit. This is the third engine. Okay. Even when you're not flying, you need air conditioning, you need your power system to activate. Okay. So there's a smaller engine which is hidden somewhere here. Okay. So this is the exhaust of that engine. It's called APU, auxiliary power unit.
When the engines are driving, you're on the ground.
Yeah, when you are not running, you don't power the engines. But if you see, you can hear the humming of that. It's all the time on when you go into board.
Which plane is this?
Sorry?
It looks like a
I can't identify, I'm sorry.
This is MD, MD11. It looks like that.
No, no, okay, what you're saying is right, it is one of the MDs.
Yeah.
Okay, because the engine at the back,
not in the back,
not
in the
MD. Yeah, it is a.
But even if you Boeing planes have engines at the back, like the Boeing 717.
This is old one.
Boeing 727 had.
717 has engine
at the back. 717 I've not even seen. I didn't answer. 707 had four. 727 had one here. And the wings. No. Yes, sir.
Normally we see the air brakes applied after landing.
That's right.
On the top of the wings being used to create the drag.
That's right.
But in mid-air also sometimes the pilot uses these flaps.
So, yeah, sometimes the
altitude.
Yeah, if the aircraft momentum is
huge drag. And reduce the speed.
That's right. Sometimes the pilot is asked to reduce speed to fit into the pattern to come and make an approach. So if he is to reduce his speed faster, then just reducing the power or reducing the thrust may not be sufficient. So in that case, he will have to deploy these air brakes.
There are two positions of the spoilers. That there's a flight mode and there's the arm mode. So the arm mode comes in play when you touch down, and the flight mode is when it just partially comes up to increase the area of which the speed reduces. It's done before landing.
Okay, very good explanation. In the air, you don't want the speed to come down so much that the aircraft stalls. So there is a limit to what this airbag will come to. Now there is an angle limitation. But once you are on ground safely, then it will come up to its full potential, and then you don't need drift, you just want the aircraft to stop the earliest. Okay, this is a torque reaction, which I said will be covered separately. When the aircraft, when the rotor blades move in one direction, the body tends to have reaction of moving in the opposite direction. That's why we need a tail rotor to keep it straight. This portion will be covered in the second part. Thrust, somebody already asked a question about thrust, and that will be covered subsequently. Before I close, I just want to touch upon stall. Stall is a condition when either the lift is reduced so much that it is not able to sustain weight. So the aircraft tends to lose height, suddenly. Okay. So on top, if you see, the airflow is quite streamlined over the larger portion of the aerofoil. In the lower one, the angle of attack is very high, so beyond a point, airflow is not able to maintain streamlines and it goes into eddies, and we call it adverse pressure. No, the benefit of lift is gone and the aircraft tends to stall or lose lift.
What's RW? RW is right wing, soar. What is RW?
Oh, it is relative airflow, relative wind.
So, you know, when the aircraft is taking off or landing in different parts of the world, the wind conditions will be very different. So does that then mean that the amount of thrust or there's a lot of adjustment done there?
Yes, you have asked the question at the right time. We are talking about relative wind. In case there is wind along the runway and wind is at the nose, that means wind is coming from ahead. We call it headwind. No? Headwind will help me in reaching that V velocity faster. If it is tailwind, I'll need much more because relative. We are talking about relative wind. That portion of the wind is going over the wings. No? So we always plan to take off and land into wind.
Okay,
that is the plan. But sometimes some runways are made only for one direction. You cannot do that.
So what adjustments are made?
No, you don't have to make any adjustment. You just calculate your takeoff distance. Okay. That you will get airborne in so much of distance, and if the wind is zero, and if you have tailwinds, then you need more distance. So you should know that with your other weight, is there enough running length available for you to get airborne? No. So that's the calculation. Okay, stall. This is just an explanation of stall. Anybody wants, we can. This is just all case know about it. These are pictorial diagram of stall. This will be covered by Captain Namdeo, stall and recovery in helicopters. Okay, is this your portion?
Thank you.
weather condition and how does it impact this the turbulence in the air, mid-air?
In the second session, which will be in early June. There we are coming something there.
Thank you, Captain Joshi. Just heard out Captain Joshi on the basic principles of flying. Good afternoon, all ladies and gentlemen. Captain Gurdeep has already mentioned as to how accomplished person Captain Joshi is. He has been a category A2 instructor, which means that he has been instructing all the flight instructors in the Indian Air Force. So, same is not the case with me, and I request you all to be a bit more patient with me. Okay, to carry forward where Captain Joshi has left. Now that everybody is all familiar with the stall, as to when a stall occurs, whether the airflow over the lift deteriorates and there is no airflow over the top of the airfoil which is left, and thereafter there is no lift and the aircraft stalls and doesn't produce any lift. This is how a classical stall in a basic basic aircraft will look like. If you try and maintain the altitude with reducing speed, if you reduce the speed and still try and maintain the altitude, and you'll have to increase the angle of attack. At one point of time, the angle of attack, you will surpass the critical angle of attack, wherein the lift over the top surface of the airfoil will break and the aircraft will drop. However, basic aircrafts are made in such a fashion that the nose of the aircraft is heavy. The aircraft nose drops down, the lift builds up, and this again gets the aircraft out of the stalled region. However, helicopter stalls are a bit peculiar in the sense that before the stalls occur, you will have increased vibrations, the aircraft will tend to pitch up, and if you still continue increasing the speed, the aircraft will roll to the retreating side. And how do you recover from a stall? You recover exactly in the opposite sense the way you recover in the fixed wing. You reduce speed, you reduce power, and you come out of the stall. Going back to the same slide, just to carry the story forward. Here onto the diagram are the top of two helicopters, two rotors. The left one is a rotor which is in a steady hover. The right one is the helicopter or the rotor which is moving forward. Onto these slides, the rotors are moving counterclockwise. The blades onto your right, as you see, are moving forward on both the diagrams. So now what happens in a forward, in a steady hover? The speeds on various points on the blade of due to the rotation of the blades is what is represented by these arrow vectors. They will all have a different speed at a different point of the blade. But however, both the sides will still be producing the same amount of lift, and the aircraft is in a balanced state. However, as you move forward, you would notice that the forward moving blade, the airflow coming from the front because of the speed of the helicopter, will get added onto the advancing side and will get subtracted from the retreating side. So this creates an imbalance. Siddharth, with me now. I can see people losing out. I know this is just to put everybody in the frame of.
It would kind of tilt towards the left side.
Yeah. So this is what it seems, isn't it? So also towards the root, you see the speed vectors are very less. As you move forward, there will be a region of reverse flow. This again is not producing any lift. The airflow over the top of the surface of the retreating side has also reduced quite a bit. There, the lift again, this side has also again suffered a loss of lift. The helicopter most of the time compensates for this by itself. What happens is the angle of attack onto the advancing side is reduced to maintain symmetry of lift. And onto the retreating side, it is increased so as to reduce the same amount of lift. But this can only be achieved up to a certain speed, beyond which, as Captain Joshi has already explained, you increase the angle of attack beyond a critical level, the aerofoil stalls. Here also, if you insist on increasing the speed, the aerofoil will stall at one time. And the stall will start from the leading edge of the blades and start spreading inward. And this area of reverse flow will also start extending outward on the retreating side. So this is one point where the, okay, Siddharth wants to interrupt.
No, you can, I have a question. You can finish too. I have a question for the previous diagram that you had.
Okay, so the aerodynamic environment around the blade, now that you see, there's an excess of lift onto one side, onto the right side, there's a deficient of lift onto one side, and how does it affect the helicopter envelope? It leads to limitations in speed of the helicopter. The advancing blade tip operating near speeds of sound, the compressibility effects will set in. For a standard rotor which is rotating, have a speed of about say 0.6 Mach, we tend to give out the speed in terms of Mach numbers, which have not been introduced, which is somebody can explain it.
0.6
Yeah, that makes my job slightly easier. There are people who know what is a Mach number. 1 Mach is the ratio. 1 Mach is the speed of the sound. And when we refer to the speeds of the aircraft here, I'll be calling it out as 0.6 Mach, 0.7 or 0.8 Mach. That is the ratio of the aircraft to the speed of the sound. So, our aerodynamics is divided into three very distinct phases: the subsonic flights, the transonic flights, and the supersonic flights. They all behave quite differently in these various regimes. So that's the reason this Mach number assumes importance here, and we have to take this into account whenever we factor our aerodynamics in helicopters, high-speed aerodynamics, so to say. So these blades are already operating at something around 0.6 Mach or so. If you increase the speed by, say, 200 kilometers, 250, 300 kilometers, that's another, how much increase in Mach number, anybody who can tell me? 300 kilometers per hour. 300 meters is
0.7.
Okay, 0.1, 0.15 or so. So the speed will go up to 0.75, 0.8 Mach or so. So this is where the compressibility effects will start coming in. We cannot have blades reaching Mach 1 or let the blades cross 0.9 Mach or so, where the compressibility effects will be such that blade deformity or structural failure will occur. So this limits the speed of the helicopter. However, if you try and rotate the blades slowly, you will be reaching this Mach compressibility effect or the Mach number later on. However, you will be stalling the blades onto the retreating side faster.
Can I ask
stands to reason?
The sonic boom causes a mechanical deformation. That is the speed of the rotor or speed of the aircraft?
There are no helicopters which can move at the speed of the sound. So helicopters, the blades are the flying wings, rotating wings that the helicopters have. And since the metallurgy or the design feature cannot incorporate any speed more than 0.9 Mach, so that's the limiting speed that we have onto the helicopters.
That is only the brake speed we can reach.
Yeah,
helicopter speed will be
the speed of the brake.
If you want to see that the blade is rotating at a particular speed and you add the aircraft speed.
We are only speaking of the speed of the blades.
The speed will be more at the periphery.
Ha,
yeah, periphery is the maximum. And because
blade tip speeds.
The radius is not a diameter.
We have mentioned about the advancing blade tip operating near the speeds of sound. So blade tip speeds are about 0.6, 0.7 Mach. They can increase up to 0.9 Mach, and that's it. And there's a maximum speed of the helicopters, which, to my knowledge, there's only one helicopter which has broken the maximum, which has broken the not the sound barrier, the 400 kilometer Mach. It's a Westland Lynx, a cleaned up Westland Lynx, which can fly. Up to 410 kilometers an hour. That's the maximum that we have achieved on a helicopter till date.
So, because the, if you calculate the speed of the tip, that is another 500 kilometers, or exactly 900 kilometers. So, the aircraft helicopter speed will be limited by that.
So,
that's why you never have helicopters carrying
bigger wings.
If you have bigger wings, there will be compressibility effects at a lower RPM. So these are all design trade-offs. You can spin the rotors fast, you can slow them down, you can increase the surface area or increase the dia or whatever. But then at the end of it, all story winds down to maximum of 400 kilometers per hour that the helicopter can achieve.
So, could you go close
that,
please?
This one?
No, that one. So. It's saying that I have to move forward, there's an increase in velocity of the airflow, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so here, you know, which direction does it end up going in? It goes in the direction where the velocity is the highest.
Okay, okay. This helicopter is moving from your side up the screen. So this is the velocity vector that is that it is encountering from the front. This helicopter is moving up the screen. Okay, limitations to maximum helicopter altitude. So now our helicopter flight envelope is again limited because of the engine and aerodynamic considerations. Like we have already discussed, the power reduces with altitude. Why? Because the density of the air reduces as you climb up. The air being less dense, less mass of airflow which is entering the engine, less mass on which the engine is working on, and subsequently less the power which is produced. Aerodynamic considerations, again, less dense the air, like Captain Joshi had given you the formula, CL half rho V square S, that rho is the density reduces, the lift reduces.
It shouldn't be the case for fixed air airplane,
yeah, it is. The aerodynamic holds good for all the aircraft.
But then they are able to go much higher.
That's an engine consideration. You fly much higher, you get a better engine efficiency as you go up. So all fixed wing aircraft would like to fly higher and higher, the jet engines.
So to compensate all of that, you know, V square is what you can easily control.
Ha.
And because it's a square thing, it's, you know,
with the small exponential increase in the lift that you get here.
So
the
high speed is that.
Yeah, yeah. In a plane. In a helicopter you cannot change the limit of the drone.
Okay, and design considerations. You may not like to go up higher. The helicopters are generally meant to fly low and slow. The utility is in flying low and slow. However, there are helicopters which have flown up to 40,000 feet also. But then these helicopters are stripped down to minimum, no external projections, cleaned up aircraft, even stripped out of all the seats, carry minimum fuel, single pilot, and you, then it only becomes something like a technological demonstrator, you just cannot do anything about it.
Slow concept
vehicle. Ha, just to demonstrate. So if you want to demonstrate, then you can go to 40,000. If you actually want to utilize the helicopter, there's no utility at 40,000.
Okay. calibrated by that. It's a Mach 1 upset.
Correct.
So, first of all, you have to fly lower range.
So, what limits the maximum altitude, the air density, rotational velocity of the rotors, and the blade surface area, as we have seen here. Okay, during our talks, I had also come across many of my friends who had asked me earlier as to why cannot you land a helicopter vertically down from a height. So he says, if you see a spot over, if you see a spot, why don't you come over directly over maybe 500 feet and directly come down? Why do you have to always make an approach something like an aircraft, a fixed wing aircraft? So let's see if what I have here. Let's see if my explanation satisfies you all. This is a high velocity diagram which I have pulled out for my helicopter. It has altitude, heights in AGL which are plotted here in feet on the y-axis and airspeed in knots plotted on the x-axis. So this is called a high velocity diagram or also the dead man's curve. Here the manufacturer restricts you or to fly in the shaded portion, and these are all weight dependent. Say suppose I am flying at 6500 feet, I should be avoiding flying between, avoiding hovering between 125 feet down to about 18 feet. And this is the shaded region that I should not be getting into to ensure a safe flight. So this nose of this curvature extends maybe up to about 17 knots here at 50 feet for all of the cases. So why is it given so? There are various avoid regions which are given in our manual. If you would like to fly as per the manual, you should be out of this, because in case you have a engine flame out or loss of power for whatever reason, you will not be able to effect a safe landing. So anytime you have to make an approach, you have to come in something like this. Your speeds up from whatever 60 knots, bringing the speed down to 20, 10, and maintaining out of the curve, thereby that is reducing speed at those speed and height combinations.
That's why when the Americans went to kill Bin Laden, they took two Black Hawk helicopters. And one helicopter actually crashed outside the compound because of the high walls. So a low pressure area was created between the wall and the base of the helicopter. That's why it didn't have enough lift and it crashed.
Good, yeah, that's news to me. Thanks. Like, I never knew it. And of course, I should have done my
seemingly
homework.
One of the helicopter
crash. One helicopter crash. There are so many aspects to it. The operation was all at night. They were using NVGs and night vision goggles. And there's so many things which all compounded the problem. So, okay, now that you all know this and you still insist on continuing in the region of reverse or the avoid area of the graph.
In the case that could we go back once? Yeah. So, in the case that
we
don't end up having engine failure, is a safe landing possible in that zone?
Yeah, a safe landing is possible. I'll explain.
Because you said that's only in the case of power loss.
If I still insist in coming at 50, 60, 70 feet and thereafter start a descent down to 0 feet and make a landing, I have to be an excellent pilot. Because if I have, this is what is going to happen. I'll just explain it to you. I have various 1, 2, 3 and 4 situations given here. The first helicopter that you see is in a hover, a free air hover. That is, it's quite a distance from the ground and in free air. The second helicopter is in a state of climb. So the helicopter which is in a hover is pumping down air through its rotor This is what it, the helicopter rotors are meant for. When it climbs, it will be, it would have an increased power, increased thrust. It will be pumping down even more air through its rotor. But what happens when it starts to descend? The airflow through the rotors would have reduced. Since the aircraft is descending, there will be airflow which would be going up from around the tips. Are you able to follow the diagram?
Yes.
Okay, if I increase the rate of descent here, so what happens is this the airflow which has been going up around the corner would have turned around and start getting back into the rotors. So there will be a vortex which will be formed around the blade tips. And since you will always be having some power, this power will be kicking up more of downwash through the rotors. The downwash would have joined the circulation here. It would be aiding the circulation around the tips. So there will be a situation in which your aircraft will be trapped in the air which you have been working on in your own bubble. So this is what is a dangerous situation. This is a situation what we call as vortex ring state.
You have all different airflow from the rest of the...
Correct.
Jaguar.
You're not working on a fresh airflow. You're working in your own...
Recirculation.
Of course, yes. And Americans would like to call it settling in power. Because you have a power on your aircraft, but you still continue to settle down. The more power you apply, the worse this situation worsens, and the more the rate of descent.
How do you get out of it?
Okay, there are piloting techniques, so which I think we'll discuss later.
So the one part I didn't understand is between second and third aircraft, first the arrows are downward, why is the air going upward in the third?
These arrows that you speak of?
Yes.
Or these one? Now the aircraft is in a descent. As I said, it's in a slow rate of descent. So we are not in a steady hover. The aircraft is coming down slightly. So the relative airflow from around the helicopter is coming up. Obviously now it's a relative airflow. You go down the undisturbed air that Captain Joshi had also mentioned earlier, which is at a distance, is now coming up. And this is how there's a pattern which is formed, and if you increase the rate of descent, the vortices because of your power. Now since vortices, air enters from the top, it reduces the effective angle of attack, because of which you'll again like to apply more power. If you apply more power, more angle of attack, the situation will only keep on worsening, because there'll be more vortices which will be formed, and at the end of it. Okay, this is a helicopter that you see is in a fully developed vortex ring state. The airflow going around the tips and growing around the root is not effectively producing any lift onto these helicopters. And if you fail to realize that you are in a vortex ring state and you are not smart enough to get out, this is what is going to happen. You will arrive at a helipad. You will not land at the helipad, as we say. Can happen anywhere, and it generally does happen nearer to the ground, because that's the time you will like to reduce speed, you will have a power, and if you're not careful, if you have chosen an approach path where the winds are from behind, your speed will be low, you'll be in a near vertical descent, and if you fail to realize all these combinations of...
It can happen anywhere, but the thing is that if it happens close to the ground, you'll pass.
Yeah, if you're in a free air, there's no reason for the aircraft to be in a free air. You'll always be moving forward, transiting, commuting. But closer to the ground, once you want to land, if you are not careful, if you choose a path that you said that if you still would like to come into the regime and come down and land, then if you're not careful, this may happen. These are some of the...
Okay, these are demonstrated when we go up to 3,000 feet or 4,000 feet, we demonstrate that how we can lose height about 500 feet. But if you do it at 100 feet, 200 feet, when you approach, you lose the height so fast that by the time you initiate recovery, you would have passed.
Do the Harriers follow the same principles in takeoff and landing?
The
See, Harriers, they have vector thrust. So their aerodynamics is quite different as compared to the helicopters.
A vortex only happens during descent or can happen during ascent also in the helicopter?
It is a powered descent. So you're descending on a powered flight. Okay, I hope I have been able to explain why you cannot descend vertically. And let me come down to the aero engines. There were not many questions before I entered also. There are people who are asking me about this aero engines. What type of aero engines? How big? What fuel do you use? And are they role specific? Are these the same engines as you use in a mobile? Maybe bigger, somebody asked me, are they the car engines or the truck, Volvos?
The Rolls-Royce engine, which is pulling some of the planes, weighs up to some 16,000 kilos.
Okay, so what engines are these?
There are three main producers of engine, GE, Rolls-Royce and Pratt & Whitney.
What type of engines are these? Okay, I'll just come. Have some patience. Do you recognize this aircraft?
Like a glider? Not exactly.
It's a single-seater microlight, generally used for adventure sports. Many of you must have seen this aircraft. This is powered by it's powered by a piston engine, and it's the same engine what we use in a EST 250. If at all anybody who is familiar with that mobike of yesteryears.
EST.
It's a 250cc EST engine. Sorry, I'll go back here.
But a 250cc engine can give it enough speed.
Very light,
right? You can see the engines flying. You can see the aircraft flying here. And what aircraft is this?
Agnov
AN 225. Wow, good. Yes, I don't carry sweets here, but then service here. This is an Antonov AN 225, and it's supposed to be the world's heaviest aircraft. How much ton does it weigh?
800 to 900,000.
Slightly. This is about just about 640 tons. 640 tons, and it has six jet engines, three on either side, to carry the weight.
640 tons.
640 kgs. A380 is about 600 tons. 590, 600 tons. So, okay, the piston engines are internal combustion engines, as we already see, and jet engines are turbojets, turboprops, turboshaft. We have a bouquet of engines towards the jet engine. Otherwise, they're all derivatives of all turbojets. Piston engine, or the reciprocating engine as they are known, because the piston moves up and down into a cylinder. We are all too familiar with these engines, the piston moving up and down in a cylinder, producing the bar strokes, compressing the charge being ignited, thereafter the increase in pressure leads to pushing down of the piston, and the drive being transmitted to the crankshaft being connected to gears, and the drive being thereafter being made available at the wheels for the automobile, cars, etc. to drive. How many of you are aware of this helicopter? Have you seen this around?
Yes.
What helicopter is it? It's an R-44, of course, yes. What else?
Single rotor.
Okay, this is the same helicopter which is used here for Mumbai Darshan. If you'll be looking around, you'll find these helicopters. And this is a piston engine helicopter. It's a four-seater piston engine helicopter. And what about this? This is PC, Pilatus PC-21. This again is a piston engine, two-seater trainer aircraft, which is the latest acquisition by the Indian Air Force for basic flight training.
Issues kerams before.
Those are jet engines, those were used for advanced training. Okay, jet engines, you see they are very basic in design. Tubular construction, wherein a compressor is placed, it can be a multi-stage compressor or a single stage as I have showed here. A combustion chamber, turbine area and the nozzle to accelerate the flow as it comes out. They are all rotary engines that draw power from the flow of combustion gases, and thrust is produced by increasing velocity of air flowing through them. People who have been reading their physics well would be well aware of that formula, force is equal to mass into acceleration. Of course, you will be able to relate it here now. And they operate on Newton's third law of motion, that is, for every reaction there is an equal and opposite reaction. Okay, there have been questions which have been asked, why jet, why not pistons? So if you go over the slide here, says the jets give you a very high power to weight ratio. A 100 kg jet engine may produce up to as much as 600 to 1000 horsepower. Comparative piston engine here will be able to produce almost about 90 to 100 bhp of power, the engines that you have on your car. Naturally, the engines are large and bulky and they have numerous moving parts. Operating pressures are already very high. You cannot draw out more power out of these piston engines, whatever the design.
If we use, say, a piston engine with, say, more cylinders, like in cars would be V8 or V8 engines,
yes.
Won't that increase the bhp of the...
That will also increase the weight of the engine, isn't it? And I just come to that. And most importantly, as I said, these engines are only suitable for subsonic regime. They cannot fly supersonic. If you have to go faster into transonic and supersonic flights, you will have to have jet engine, where you can accelerate flow.
By only fighter can really break the sound barrier.
There are commercial aircraft.
It's retired now. It's too unsafe. The fuel
is also changing.
Yeah, piston engine and jet engine fuels are different. Jet engines have ATF, aviation turbine fuel, what to call. And the piston engines have a similar gasoline, have gas, aviation gasoline, which are 100 LL or what, about 100 octane, equivalent to 100 octane fuel.
Higher octane.
Okay, and as to why people would still like to use jet engines, though they are expensive, difficult to design and maintain, the startup times are more, and they are sluggish to power demands. We still are going through using jet engines on modern and faster aircraft. However, if you have to fly basic trainers and a smaller helicopters, you still go for a piston engine because it demands low maintenance, costs are low. Very quick to start, and the power demands, as you open throttle, the power is available. There's no lag in the power.
But Ashish, since there are more moving parts, won't the cost be higher for piston engine? Maintenance cost, maintenance requirements, because there's so many more moving parts.
Very true, sir. But then, this is what it is. These are very highly engineered precision engines, monoblock casting and all. So, they are difficult to maintain.
Like
the
difference between the
direction
and concentrated action.
Okay, what aircraft is this?
MiG-21.
Very good. This is a MiG-21 and it uses turbojets. It's a Turbojets are the engines which are very basic in design. They have and they are used on basically on fighter aircrafts because they have a very good power response, and they generally form the basis for all other gas turbine engines. And this is a basic turbojet. Did you see a large intake in the front? Air enters from the intake. It has got a single shaft which runs through the length of the engine. The engine itself enclosed in a cylinder shape. We have the inlet, the compressors which are lined up, various stages of compressor. Thereafter the combustion chamber, and once the air is heated up onto the combustion chamber, the hot air flows into the turbines, and some power is extracted out of these turbine blades, which are used to drive all ancillary power onto your aircraft. That's the generators, the various pumps and all. And the residual gas thereafter flows out through the nozzle. The nozzle also has a design feature which accelerates the airflow. Almost about 40% of the power is utilized here on the turbine, and 60% of the power thereafter is utilized as thrust for the aircraft to be propelled forward.
Sir, listen about afterburner happening for thrust.
Yeah.
Where does that happen?
Afterburner, the fuel is introduced into the exhaust. So the exhaust gases being so hot, in any case, the combustion occurs at around 2000 degrees centigrade. The exhaust gases are about 800 to 900 degrees. As they are ejected out, they are still very hot to ignite whatever comes in the way. As you put in more of fuel here, these gases will again burn. There will be an expansion in volume that will give it the additional propulsive forces. As you have an afterburner, which are generally a feature of all the fighter aircrafts.
Don't the engines
in a
cooling system also? What kind of cooling system?
Naturally cooling. Jet engines happen. See, that will take us onto. That will require lots of time. I think we'll meet separately and I'll tell you. Because they have a cooling system, they have all sorts of systems. All, as I said, the ancillary drive which is taken from this part goes and drives a. It gives a drive to the gearbox, wherein lot many inputs are given to the coolers, to the hydraulic pumps, to the fuel pumps, and your generators where you produce electricity for your engines to run various actuators.
Let's
take it up separately.
I think we need to meet up separately. My presentation is not matching up, it seems. Okay. What aircraft is this?
Boeing.
It's an Embraer.
500-600
ATR. It's an ATR, yes, correct. That's true. And it's about, it seats about 50 people. It's currently being operated by Air India towards regional collectivity. So this ATR uses what we call turboprops. If you notice, the engine is the same. It's a turbojet, standard turbojet engine from this end to this end. It's only a drive from the power turbine has been taken, and through a gear box, the propellers are being driven. So these are the same engines which are modified for our use.
They are called Hero Honda, I think, in the aircraft industry. They are very fuel efficient.
They are fuel efficient. They are utilized the utilities in short haul aircrafts on airfields which have short takeoff and landing distances which are available. So these engines have a turboprop which is attached to the front propellers. Propellers can push in higher mass of air and can give you higher acceleration at lower speeds, lower speed regimes.
Anyway,
so
it is a jet engine. Why can't the exhaust being used as to give it thrust?
As I said, these are specialized engines. If you would like to land on a smaller runway, maybe 3,000 feet runway, 2,000 feet runway, these are the aircraft which will help you land onto small runways and take off from that place. The jets have a longer response time. They are much more efficient as the speed builds up. So, for a jet to accelerate in 3,000 feet and thereafter getaway may not be possible. That's the reason. One of the reason as to why this turboprops are used, because so as to make them land on a smaller runway.
They only have some 5,000 feet of runway.
A few of the military aircrafts also.
Mumbai's main runway is 3,680 meters long.
Meters, correct. Yes, so meters. That's about.
Mumbai's way lesser than that. Maybe 1,500 to 2,000
meters. 3 kilometers. That's 3 kilometers. We're speaking of some 2,000 feet or 600 meters a kilometer or so. Okay. Now the turboshaft engine. What helicopter is this?
Caught them.
This is where I catch you. Okay.
You? Yes.
Correct. Who said so? Marks. This is a Dhruv advanced light helicopter from HAL. These presently form the part of SARAN team, which is the formation aerobatics team of the Indian Air Force. And all helicopters, in fact, they will all utilize a turboshaft engine. Engine again remains the same. There's a turboprop from one end to this place. Wherein, after the compressor turbine, we have placed a free turbine, another power turbine, which extracts power. And the power thereafter, which is coming out into the exhaust, is just about 10% of power which is wasted. Most of the power is all absorbed by this free turbine, which thereafter goes into a gearbox again and drives the rotors and the tail rotor.
Where is the engine located in this?
Engines are somewhere around here. If you see, this is the exhaust of the engine, and these are the intakes here. So there are two engines similarly on the other side, and drive from both the engines go to a gearbox which is mounted right below the main rotors, and this is from where all the drive is distributed for the tail rotors, and the driving thrust to the helicopter is available. Okay, the requirement here is that you have to maintain the main rotor RPM constant. So that's the reason this is a free turbine. This is not attached to the main shaft of the engine. It's just these two turbines do not have any connection in between them, physical connection in between them. The RPM of this turbine is governed. Anytime the RPM of this turbine varies, this communicates it to the main engine through a governor. The governor thereafter signals the engine to increase or decrease the fuel flow to match the power demands of the main rotor. This is how thereafter the helicopters maintain their RPM and fly. Okay. Now, what aircraft or what engine is this?
Boeing 787.
787, 737 or whatever. They all have the same engine?
No.
You would all be very familiar with the type of the engine.
Yeah, is it a Rolls Royce or General Electric that we...
Good, I am very impressed. And this is a turbofan engine. And why do you, what you see in front of this engine is the fan portion of it.
Yeah.
Isn't it? And you can still see light behind. That means these engines are all hollow?
Yeah.
Okay, again, if you see, these are the same engines, the turbo jets that we have seen. And a huge fan fitted in front of it.
One question. At the tip of that, as a nose, this
guy has a nose.
What role does that play?
Pardon?
See, at the tip of it, when
you
look at
from
the side, it has kind of a nose at the tip of it. What role does that play?
It sucks in the air.
This is a cone.
Okay, this is just to smoothen out the fan. So, there's a cone which is cone. just to smoothen out the airflow. It doesn't mean anything much here. Otherwise, you would have been seeing nuts and bolts and so many things inside. Okay, so now how does it help us? Why the turbofans to start with?
Basically, sucks in the air and the air goes and meets the fuel and the combustion chamber.
Okay.
And the combustion chamber lights up the fuel and that's how thrust is produced and the air is released from the back.
That's only some 20% of the portion that you have spoken of. If you see, there's a fan which is placed here. The fan throws in the air behind. Most of the air, in this case, these are also known as high bypass ratio engine or turbofan engines. Most of the air, almost about 70 to 80% of the air flows around the engine. And only about 10 to 20% which enters here, thereafter follows the same pattern as you have said. It is compressed through the compressors, comes into the combustion chamber, is burnt up here with the fuel, and thereafter goes into the turbine where the power is extracted for ancillary equipment, and the rest of the portion thereafter produces that jet thrust to propel the aircraft. So, why do you want this aircraft airflow to be flowing from outside?
To cool the engine.
Okay, yes, that's one.
So to increase more thrust because there's more
mass flow. There's
more
a principle, there's a concept called mass flow.
Fuel efficiency.
They all will add up finally. What this fan is doing is it is moving the air flow around the engine. In the first this thing instance, as he said, the this thermal efficiency, the aircraft, the engine is cooled to a reasonable limit. It increases the life. The thermal stress are less. And once this air reaches the exhaust, it adds up to the exhaust. It expands because of the heat. So the exhaust temperatures also reduce. And it, the expansion also gives it a bigger jet velocity. So it helps in further acceleration of the aircraft.
But the word
hit
is also very much in this type of
movement. It provides a very big frontal view.
Yeah.
Target. It's a good target for all these birds. Okay, just to give you an example as to how big the engine can be, this is an engine of Boeing 777, correct? This is a Boeing 777. And the fan diameter is almost about 3.25 meters.
It's as big as the whole area of a 737's cabin.
See this? I was just about to say so. Thanks. Yeah, I know.
I think a big round of applause for
you. Are you sure? And,
next up, yes. Yeah.
This is a Boeing 787 engine, Trent 1000. This is again a Rolls-Royce engine. Two engines delivering a power of about 68,000 kg force. And if you see the numbers here, they suck up almost about one squash court equivalent of air in 1 second. Or one, they can empty out about a football area of a football field or a big stadium in about a minute. That's the amount of air that these engines are working on. So, like I said, the more air you work upon, more force that you, the engine will produce, mass into acceleration, more mass and more force. Air passing through compressor is compressed to 50 times the normal air pressure before it reaches the combustion chamber. So, compression ratio is about 1 is to 50. High bypass ratio, they have a bypass ratio of 1 is to 10. 10 parts flow from outside the engine and 1 part only flows through the engine, which is producing the thrust. The combustion chamber has a temperature of about 2000 degrees and the force of the fan blades can take almost about 100 tons. You can hang a 100 ton truck over a fan blade that you see here and it will not break, which is compared to some 10 tons which are first generation turbine engines would take, that was just about 30 years back.
Sometimes you see a flame, you know, behind the fighter planes, especially. Is that the reason that 2000 degrees centigrade, like your temperature you are saying?
Or once you see the flames will only be seen once you have put in your reheat on.
Afterburners, we call it afterburners.
In process of afterburners, you introduce fuel after the turbines. That's the exhaust gases. So these are the there's the fuel which is burning, which is seen outside.
Okay. So you are you reusing those gases, hot gases, kind of?
No. These are the gases now. The gases are imported at, because they have now increased in volume further. They are imported at greater acceleration, which is now utilized by these aircraft to accelerate.
I think turbo also decides fuel and air ratio. But at what ratio they have to mix, which eventually decides
the fuel ratio. Correct. Okay, there are a few of my people, a few of my friends who had again asked me to explain this concept of tail rotors as to why should there be a tail rotor, why cannot you lay out a rotor again horizontally so as to give you thrust and so on and so forth. So I thought I'll just try and explain as to why a tail rotor is required.
That's for direction.
That is an anti-torque device that is used for torque compensation. So if you rotate a rotor onto the blades, rotate the rotor in one direction, the helicopters will always tend to rotate in the opposite direction, isn't it? A torque will be formed and the torque will try and rotate the helicopter in the opposite direction. So that's the reason you need to put in a tail rotor there to stop this rotation or some form of anti-torque compensation. And what compensations can be put in? The tail rotor, which is a conventional design, the ferrostrons, tandem rotors, contra rotating, where if you don't have any rotors at all, you will see these designs as we go by. A conventional tail rotor, you have the helicopter which is hovering here, blades rotating contra clockwise, the nose would like to rotate to the right, a torque would have been set up between these two forces. So that's the reason you put in a tail rotor which produces a thrust onto your right, which can keep the nose straight.
Does the length of a blade in the tail rotor affect the anti-torque motion? You know the anti-torque effect that you're talking about?
Yes.
Does the length of a blade of the tail rotor increase or decrease, or does it have any difference to the factor?
Yes. As I said, we'll meet later. You need to say this distance.
The one in the tail rotor.
Yes.
So if a blade is slightly longer or shorter, does it affect the anti-torque?
I think that's what he's explaining. It's dependent on the length of the gap, the speed with which the tail rotor is moving.
Moment arm. You are speaking of moment arm, if I understand correctly, is it?
Talking about how, so we're talking about how we're trying to conquer torque and how we're talking about anti-torque devices. So does the length of it affect it, length of a blade of a tail rotor?
Length of blade of tail rotor. Yes, of course. CL half of B square is S is the area, surface area of the blades.
So
both the length, both the area, or you increase the size of the length of the blade odd-wise, or you increase the length like this, they'll all contribute to increase in the surface area, which will produce more lift, more thrust. So, all design features will come to it.
But there are choppers without the tail rotors also.
I'll come to that, sir. The fenestrals. So now this word fenestral has come from a French word, if I know correctly, which means a small window. The tail rotor is placed in a small window, shrouded tail rotors. Utility is that it enhances safety. The stones which are picked up, they don't go into the tail rotors, damage the tail rotors, tail rotor failure instances reduces. And they require a small space for them to be accommodated. Almost about 70% of dia of fenestron is 70% of the main rotor blade tire is used for thruster to produce the same amount of anti-lock thrust. This is an EC.
In the conventional tail rotor, see for example the one that you showed is on the right hand side of the tail. Okay. Does the side make a difference? I mean, is it happening in the same place on the
Yes, it does. That's what it says. So, but then I think we'll run out of time if you.
It's just a design feature.
Design feature. I'll tell you as to how much it is. Okay. Now there are no tail rotors onto these helicopters. So how do they wrap it?
They work in counter movement. One goes in clockwise, one goes anti clockwise.
So I need not need to explain. Two blades which are moving in the opposite direction, they don't produce any anti lock. So that's how the anti lock action is achieved. Now what about these helicopters? What helicopter is this?
That's Cambo.
Okay. Cambo, correct. KA-225. These are the latest acquisition by the Indian Army. They just started arriving. And this is a KA-32, Cambo 32, which is in service with the Indian Navy. So these are contra-rotating rotors. One rotor rotating clockwise, the other rotating anti-clockwise. And both these rotations will cancel out the torque forces. And there is no requirement of a tail rotor here. Now these are the choppers without tail rotor, and one of them is here also. And so how do they produce the anti-lock force? They have come up with a very unique concept, what we call contra effect. What happens is, this is a cutout portion of the same helicopter. The air, the tail rotor, a conventional tail rotor is not here, but a small fan which is placed inside the boom. The air is sucked in from the top, and the fan thereafter works over the air, pushes it through the boom, and the air is let out as a residual flow. But before it is let out, there are slits on the other side. If you see the aircraft from the back, onto the right side, there are slits through which the air is pushed out or through a force. So now we have the main rotor blade which is pushing down air from the top. The air runs along the tail boom on both the sides. But however, since we have slots onto the right side here, these slots have a high velocity air which energizes the flow, and it continues, the airflow continues along the tail boom onto one side. So we have a situation wherein the airflow starting from the top is going around traveling a greater distance as compared to the one onto the left which is traveling a lesser distance. Again, Bernoulli's theorem that need not be explained. So because of which there is a thrust which is being produced onto the right as seen here. However, if at all there is a need to balance the thrust, there is a vectored airflow. The airflow is turned about 90 degrees onto the side. These and connected through a cone which can be opened up or closed. So to balance the yawing or condition, this thing is connected to your pedals here. The pilot applies the pedal, the opening closes or opens. And these are all push-pull rods which are here. And that's how the opening thereafter adjusts or balances out whatever additional yaw forces that you may require in this case to balance out.
But if it's not open, if you say it's not open, what happens when the air collects there?
It flows out the slits here, and this is always open. It just cannot, it's not an airtight thing. So I cannot move it and show. Okay. So, gentlemen, this is a design which is patented by MD Helicopters. So, it has naturally lots of advantages. It's extremely safe. you can land anywhere, you don't have to worry about tail rotors getting hit or the people getting hit because of the tail rotors. It reduces noise because now there's one less tail rotor which is working on the air, reduces the pilot workload because over forces are being balanced out automatically, less of aircraft vibration again because there's only one rotor which is operating in the free air. Okay, this is the these are the slides for which nobody has asked me any questions. These are the slides which have been introduced by me. Nobody had asked me what's the future of helicopters, so I thought I'll just give you an insight. These are the helicopters. If you see, they have wings also, and they have a propeller which is mounted behind. So once you get airborne, these are all concept aircrafts. So once you get airborne, these are still in the experimental stage. The rotors are offloaded because the wings will start producing the lift. Or it may also happen that the wings can be slowed down or completely stopped. So when thereafter it will be a fixed wing aircraft.
Offloaded means it will be folded off.
No, no, they can stop in a position for this aircraft, for this thing to start operating again once you are to land. So this becomes a fixed wing now with a wing here and a pusher prop here, which is thereafter. And you can achieve higher speeds, higher efficiencies because of this. Have you seen this aircraft ever flying around?
Avatar.
Correct. And these are currently being tried out by US Army. So these will be the face of the helicopters to come in future. This is another tilt rotor design. These are V-22 Osprey, which are already flying for the US Navy. They are not in commercial production, but yes, they will soon be in commercial production now. And one more helicopter that was showcased in Dallas Air Show in Jan 2018. This is one of these Bell helicopter concept design. And today morning when I was coming here, I went through this news when NASA is planning to send helicopters onto the Mars. So this is what the extent of helicopters here is.
The future is bright.
So this gentleman, I finish off my talk.
Yeah, just show that helicopter. Actually, Captain Namdeo flies this helicopter.
Oh,
okay. Yeah.
This way.
Wonderful. So, I have also a question. So, do aircrafts have gears? Forward gears, reverse gears?
No.
No reverse gear. No reverse.
Forward gears?
No.
Must be here.
Landing gear.
unlike automobiles, aircrafts don't have any gears. But yeah, you know, it's very intriguing when you sit in a flight and then you're waiting for the aircraft to take off and there's a lot of congestion, especially in Bombay. So there's an ATC, you know, that the pilot will say there's a lot of congestion, ATC advises that it will take us X number of minutes before we take off. They don't say that, they say before we push, before we commence, push back. They said before we commence, push back. So why do they say that? Why do they say before we commence, push back?
They cannot take a reverse.
Has to be
they are pushed back.
So they are, you're saying they can't reverse themselves,
yes.
They are pushed back.
No,
so
they actually can be reversed, but the FCDM and you suggest that they can't do this to one.
They actually can be reversed by changing, I
so
guess.
Reverse thrust.
They can actually, you know, change the wing, the design of the wing. They can be small change can be made in that. But it's actually not done. So there's a pushback tractor or a tug which is used, which pushes them till they reach a point where they can start their engines and they can be on their own. So it's a very interesting field. So thanks so much, Captain Namdeo, Captain Joshi. Interactive, extremely demonstrative. You know, you actually demonstrated a lot of things. So the concepts became more clear. Obviously, there is too much. The complexity of this aviation, field of aviation is far more than we can handle in 2 hours. I wish that we could have had a workshop. You know, like this is a session. I wish we could have given it a workshop.
Yeah.
where we took a few concepts but discussed them in more detail. But here we tried to cover a lot of concepts, but maybe at a more cursory level. But you know, I think it's a great building. At some point in future, if there is enough interest, we may want to again bother you to conduct maybe a series of smaller workshops. With more focus on children, because I think children are more curious than adults, and rightfully so. Because some of them will finally become pilots, fighter pilots, helicopter pilots, commercial air pilots. So that that's a wish list for future. But for the present, I guess it's a wonderful 2 hour session. We had one gentleman who came all the way from Bangalore. He took a flight from Bangalore, landed in Bombay. Suresh, he's here. And he was so passionate.
Can we have a
file
with Captain Joshi?
Not
question answers.
Yeah, sure, you can. Some of you can stay back and have that session. So I just want to extend my thanks and my gratitude for the fact that you come and you, not only entered, given us a lot of knowledge, but also kind of picked our curiosity that we should know more, because we are losing this battle with children,
Yeah.
Children know much more than we know. So we don't like it. And I probably felt very hurt that, a lot of my friends tell me you are very knowledgeable. So that my secret got the real self, that I actually know very little. And these children are far ahead of us.
Yeah.
And I would like all adults to rekindle that childlike curiosity, the sense of inquiry, the thirst for knowledge. And they should not believe that once they've started graying or losing hair, that's the end to their learning. So I would kind of request all of us to take back that mindset of a child to keep learning. And also I would request that as parents, we should also fuel our children's curiosity. We should keep, creating environment around them where they can ask questions. They can feel curious, because that's how, they will, obviously they will expand their knowledge, retain their curiosities, ask what are whys, and ask why not. And that is how new inventions will take place. And the world will become probably a better world for us. So on that note, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And maybe we can ask Captain Joshi and Captain Namdeo to maybe take a few questions for people who want to stay back and have some questions.
Come, Namdeo. Yeah, please go ahead. Whatever we can answer now, we'll try it.
There are a lot of people who suffer from fear of flying.
Fear of
flying. Yeah, what do
you tell? Accident rate of flying by air is much, much less than road accidents. Much, much less. Number of people dying of air accidents is a very small fraction of number of people who die on roads or in bathrooms.
Why is the
aircraft
not fall?
Why is the aircraft doesn't fall? Because it has got wings and the lift is created. So as long as the aircraft is moving forward, the lift will be there, aircraft will not fall.
What is the difference, very basic question, what is the difference between flying a small aircraft and a much bigger aircraft?
Technology, more advanced technology is used for bigger aircraft, wing surface.
I am talking from the perspective of skills.
Yeah, that's right. That's what I'm talking about. So, just beyond just basic skills to fly, the knowledge base also has to be much better, much bigger. The pilot who flies 747 as compared to, like tomorrow he can go and start with his pilot license. The information base which he has to have is much, much more.
What is the maximum number of people in aircraft?
I think 380 is the aircraft.
No,
yeah, what is the number?
500.
Around 500.
500.
Yeah. Earlier 747 used to be the champion, now 380.
No,
Anybody has 30 rows.
A380 in a standard configuration carries about 500, but in all aerodromic configuration it can carry as much as 800 rows. So,
from a career perspective, for anyone who wants to become a pilot or an aeronautical engineer, now what is the process to be followed? Like after 12th or something, is it something, there is a pilot training kind of thing? Or
he can tell you, his son is just this slow, he can be a pilot.
Thanks, sir. Okay. For getting into a career in aviation, the requirements aren't much. You only need to have lots of money. That's only requirement. So apart from that, 12th is the basic qualification. Thereafter, you are allowed to appear for license examinations. Physics, mathematics are compulsory subjects that your son should have. And after 12th, you are allowed to appear into this this tests, wherein you can be, wherein you can have various types of licenses that you can ask for. That is PPL, CPL, ADPL, isn't it? So, to acquire a license, subjects are only one part of the training. You need to have flying, so minimum 250 hours for a CPL flight. So 250 hours of flight will cost you something, ground subject training will cost you something. At current level, what I know of it is about CPL costs about 20 lakhs to complete, and which is provided by the Narsingh Guruji Institute in the Sherpur complex.
I think also depends upon career in technical side vis-a-vis flying side. These are the two aspects.
Correct.
Because aeronautic, when you want to be a technical side, then you have to get into aeronautic engineering.
Aeronautical engineering.
And flying is a different thing.
Flying
altogether. These are two parallel.
Correct.
So you don't need a degree to fly.
Yeah. You don't need a degree to fly.
Engineering.
And currently, I fly with my experience, I have come across quite a few. Supply of flyer is more than demand. There are many unemployed pilots, trained pilots.
This trend is going to reverse very soon.
Very soon.
I know one guy having flying training from US, spending 25 lakhs in a real estate business, a real estate carrier.
So he'll get a job very soon.
Sir, now this is where the difference is. CPL can be obtained spending 20 to 25 lakhs, as you said. But most of the airlines who are operating the commercial airlines, now since there is a slightly more demand of pilots as compared, and which the trend which has already started reversing, the airlines would like you to have a type rating. This type rating, that is the Boeings and the A320s which are in vogue nowadays, require almost as much as about 80 lakhs for endorsement.
Yeah.
So, a crore is an amount that you should be looking forward to for 2-3 more.
Nebrar, that guy, that young boy, he has undergone training from US. Apart from that, in addition to that, he had gone special training for Airbus. He's a further upgradation. In addition to restricting flying in general, he rather went for special training on Airbus.
Okay.
And with the Airbus, whatever it is, still is a jobless.
Sir, must be quite unusual because.
Maybe under what the reason, I don't know.
Yeah, no, because
but there must be something. Smart guy, very smart guy. Who rather selected for that training also, for which you spent money.
Must be successful.
His
smartness
should be valued by
the
maybe too smart.
Actually, his smartness can be evaluated by the
there is extra smart.
So just to complete your question,
yeah.
There's a medical requirement also,
yeah.
That you need to have if you would like to acquire this license. This license will have a medical, should have a medical validity, it should have your flying component and the ground subjects that we spoke of. So now you get the license. Thereafter, the type ratings and further checks and whatever you need to fly to be competent enough to fly.
So, any institutes in Mumbai itself or?
Like I mentioned, Narsingh Guruji is one institute. They have a campus at Sherpur, which is about 400 kilometers from this place, right off the plane.
Malegaon, near Malegaon.
You
are a basic question. Most of the helipads have marked X and a big circle. Whereas an helicopter can land anywhere, even without that mark, like if it is in a favorable condition. What is the importance of that?
It's legal. It's completely legal, right? It's legal to land.
It can land still and land.
And a certain amount of area clearance to land.
H marking for a helipad.
Yeah.
Some places, even hospitals have H marked on top. So that you can
designated spots. How do you designate a spot?
Yeah,
if I
can land.
Okay. Now, I'll be legally not be correct if I would be going around landing at all the places. I require to take a permission to go and land at a certain place.
Yeah, but you have a handicap as a permission.
Yes,
example. So that's the reason they park a landing spot. And if it is a landing spot, then it will be meeting some requirements of that landing spot. It will have a approach and takeoff direction which will be free. There will be some gradient which will be available for you.
to make an approach and so on and so forth. So this is what.
Like a motorbike.
That area is already tagged and identified as a place which is suitable for landing. From the approach perspective, from the takeoff perspective, from the obstructions and all those things. So there is a particular criteria, there are conditions for a helipad. One, I mean, how do you select a helipad? So there are a lot of, you know, there are rules which are there. That what all things you have to have for a helipad. Mm-hmm. So what is the angle? What I mean, if there are trees, how far they should be? What is the, you know, elevation of all those things?
So we see in television most of these politicians who fly from here to there.
No, they also get the helipad.
These criteria.
The helipads are selected by the district administration, and they are marked. So that, you know, they have got a book in which everything is given.
Yeah, what is defined?
There's a DGCA rule on how the helipad is to be identified and how to be marked. So there are lots of
it's not
they give the coordinates.
SSG, they are called supersonic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.